You know what? I'm gonna take a night. Okay, guys, we're done. Now. I'm gonna let the camera keep recording. Okay, go ahead. Shit. In a shower. Mostly a shower. don't want to have sex so bad. Fuck you, fuck you. Fucking shit hit. Yeah. Talk to my rabbi. I had sex last week with Tiffany. I gave her 12. I'm gonna watch porn. Yeah, well, I'll do that in a bit. If I can't find it on TV, I'm gonna have to do that because it's not on TV. I'm gonna watch some on YouTube. No, maybe use YouTube stuff. Mostly YouTube, not porn. It's too late for that, I think. I don't know, I'm gonna watch it. If I can't find it on YouTube, then if I can't find it on camera, I have to like it on YouTube. Nope, it's not on TV. There's nothing on TV, so cut this off. I'm gonna see what's on TV. I'm gonna see what's on YouTube. Watch it on YouTube. Watch it on the tablet, and then that's about all I'm gonna do. Let the camera die out, let the camera view whatever it's doing. And tomorrow I'll upload the footage to YouTube. That's it. So tomorrow I got a couple things to do. Pictures and some other things to do. So I got one full camera, I got two full cameras already. I got two full cameras, which I'm going to take care of later. I got one more camera I have to fill up, and that's it. Which I'll do by tonight. Right now I'm gonna watch some YouTube videos or something like that.
Both.
Yeah,
I
do
both at once.
The cat's gonna be spawned. Put some other YouTube channel to watch. Then watch something else. And who knows what. The question that I've wanted to know for a while Yes, this video will be demonetized or not, doesn't really matter. Because today doesn't really matter. So this was kind of going to give us the question that we wanted to know for about over 20 years now. It's an early version of SpongeBob, it's an early episode. This guy actually took the time to uncripple code this show, episode, kinda. It's good. You see? And. Okay, guys, it does not make any sense. I just listened to this for you guys, it made no sense, but it's not my problem. It's someone else's problem. Because it does not sound right, and that'd be cool to see in real life. But you know that's not gonna happen. Let's start the theme. So let's see here. What should we do? So it's the. So crabs is a. Okay, makes a lot of sense. Now let's do some fun stuff that I can do on the channel. Got what I need done for the day, so I'm trying to make a little bit of filler. Oh, right there. Harder. Right there. That'd be funny if that was true. Two videos. So you'll see here, what do I want to put on? I wish I could do what he does, but I can't do it because one, I'm not that powerful. If I could, I would do what I really want to do. But, Meet me. Harder. Yeah, right, I'd always do that. That's not going to happen in a million years. You think we're still watching some? Yeah, I am, but there's something I wish I could do, but you know what, though? I'm watching this
for rich Middle Eastern appliance. It sold it for £55,000, which was about 82,000. The 1980s are often remembered for some of the bold moves that were taken. From the space shuttle and MTV to the fall of communism, the decade was full of changes. However, not everything was a hit. Saw its share of bad designs and styles. The automotive industry was no exception. The 1980 Chevrolet Citation was GM's attempt at competing with the sleek European hatchbacks. But this vehicle proved to be unreliable, which was shocking considering it had the name Citation. In reality, the police should have issued a citation to anyone driving this vehicle because it was so darn ugly. The 1983 Glen Burnie Facet was a unique-looking car, to say the least. I'm not sure what's going on here, but it looks like it had pieces from numerous cars, and it had some sort of genetic disorder. This car was from a British company that customized vehicles for rich Middle Eastern clients. They sold it for £55,000, which was about $82,000 at the time. If you bought this ugly car, then it was proof that you had way too much money. The 1980 Toyota Corolla Tercel was definitely a mouthful to say. Was it a Corolla or a Tercel? Who knows, but it was an ugly compact car. They really looked cheap and they sure didn't win over many people. It's no wonder why people referred to them as the Tercel. The 1980 Cadillac Seville was a normal Cadillac in the front, but when you walked around to the back, it had problems. It looked like it had backed up into something, or maybe had a slice taken out of the trunk. Many people either loved or hated it, but as we look back on this one, I'm sure that most of us hated it.
Not Caddy, it's a piece of shit.
The 1984 Zimmer Quicksilver sounds like something that should be cool, but it wasn't.
Zimmer?
The car had chrome accents all over that just looked out of place.
Looks like a horrible Lincoln.
It did, but it gave the impression that it had a powerful engine, but it only had a horrible V6 in it.
Oh.
The price tag on this flattened-looking car was $50,000, which was about the same price as a Mercedes during the same time period.
I buy the Merc!
I get a VL, huh? 1980s Japanese automakers came on strong, but the 1985 Subaru XT was a little weak. The front end was
cute,
but it looked like they gave up on designing the rear end. Overall, it sort of looked like a doorstop. The LCD dash had the appearance of a cheap video game, and the steering wheel was also odd-looking.
Looks like a gun.
And we won't even mention what the gear shifter looked like.
It sure looks like a gun.
The 1989 Escargot was a fiber band
that looked
cute. Like a snail. What a fitting name, right? Escargot? Did it? Really, the S just stood for what it really was. A big honking piece of This vehicle was only available in Japan. I guess they were too embarrassed to take this one into other countries. In 1987, Nissan came out with another bad creation. The Nissan Pulse Oregon X is a perfect example of what not to do in a car. Its claim to fame was that it had an interchangeable rear hatch. You either had the choice between an ugly hatchback or a stupid-looking wagon. Surprisingly, this car never caught on with consumers. I guess it had no pulse. The Fiat Panda came out in 1980, and it was supposed to be a basic economy car. It basically created something that was only fitting corners on quality. The car had straight-edged sheet metal, and the bumpers were unpainted. The seats were highly uncomfortable, and the car itself looked like a disposable Polaroid camera. And what's going on with the grill intake that's only on one side? For some reason, Fiat kept this litter box in production for 23 years.
Must have been good for something.
Thankfully, this one never made it to the U.S., but the Nissan 1400 pickup was sold in
it's
South
cute.
Africa.
It's cute.
Not only was it ugly, but the cab was very small. People who were taller than 5 foot 9 inches had trouble squeezing into this high-performance donkey cart. The 1981 Maserati Viterbo was supposed to be sleek and sexy, but in reality, they were underpowered and a pain to work on. That was important to know because they were unreliable as well. I'm not quite sure what they were trying to accomplish with this one, but it checks all the boxes for one terrible car. Cadillac went to an all-new low with the 1982 Cadillac Cimarron. You've probably forgotten about these, and for good reason. They were extremely ugly and almost pulled the company down the drain. The car had absolutely nothing special about it, and it was a commercial failure. It left most people wondering why it even had the Cadillac badging on it. Initially, they put an 80-horsepower four-cylinder engine in it, and later on, they upgraded it to a V6 with a whopping 130 horsepower. No matter what they did to the car, it continued to be a piece of crap. The 1984 Ford Tempo was created to be more
friendly
with a more modern styling. The design was...
I had a Ford Tempo. It was a two-door coupe, but I had a Ford Tempo. It was a two-door, and that thing went like a top. A Ford Tempo was four-door. No, I had a Ford Tempo, but mine was a two-door, and that thing ran like a top. That thing was fun. That thing was fast. That thing was awesome to drive.
Pretty bland, and even the headlights looked depressed. But if you didn't like this Ford version, then you could always upgrade to the Mercury Topaz, which was really the same uninspiring design.
The tempo was pretty good.
The 1981 AMC Eagle Combat was a pretty strange vehicle. AMC was the same company that brought you the Gremlin.
And
in the 1980s, the company had many vehicles that were outdated and were beginning to have financial troubles.
Spice.
Alfa Romeo came out with the Milano in 1985. It was supposed to be a larger car, but it was then determined that it needed to be smaller. It's pretty clear that they didn't know what to do with this one. But hey, this particular model has racing stripes, and it makes it all better, right? Hyundai's breakthrough car into the American market was the 1985 Excel. It did not win any beauty contests, but the affordable price of $4,995 helped it to sell 168,000 units during its first year, which solidified the South Korean brand. However, no one is showing these at classic car meets, which means that they are just better off rusting away in junkyards. In the 1980s, the Ford Thunderbird was showing out the Monte Carlo in the NASCAR racing. In an effort to
boxy bird,
the GM released the Aero Group on the Monte Carlo in 1986, as well as the Pontiac Grand Prix 2+2. It really had the appearance like they just slapped extra glass on the rear rather than engineering something better in a proper build. They were actually odd-looking, and thankfully this didn't stick around. Believe it or not, there are actually some car fanatics that love these. The Lincoln Mark 7 was basically an upscale version of the Ford Thunderbird and Mercury Cougar. The LSC model had the same engine as the Mustang GT, but the overall styling was a bit off. It sported chrome overhangs that stuck out on both ends, and the trunk was just plain ugly. There were quite a few of these on the road, but that certainly did not mean that they were good looking. Probably the worst looking car from the 80s had to be the Yugo, which came out in 1985 and stayed around in the U.S. until 1992. The Yugo 45 came with a 1.0-liter engine that had 45 horsepower. Later on, Yugo souped them up with a 1.3-liter engine that had a high output of 65 horsepower. Initially, the Yugo sold somewhat well, but as the years went on, they sold less. They were the cheapest cars that you could possibly buy. If you ever rode in one, you could certainly tell. There were tons of jokes made about this car, like Yugo when you push, or how about the rear window defroster to keep your hands warm while you pushed it in the winter. These cars were not only ugly, but they were extremely unreliable.
They also killed a person driving the back of a bridge.
For every nice car that was made in the 80s, there were probably 10 to 15 ugly ones. We certainly couldn't include every ugly car in this short video, but what are some of the ones that we missed? Let us know in the comments below. Thanks for watching.
Like the 2101. And the same way, absolutely nothing like the Texas. get one. By the way, if you're wondering why I'm so focused on Hungary, that's where this and my Lada are from. In comparison to the Trabant, Rolls Royce, the Trabant has two cylinders. This has four. This engine is two-stroke. Four-stroke. The oil stays in the engine. Two doors. Four doors. Two seatbelts. For four seats. Really, four seatbelts. It's actually five, I lied. 26 horsepower. Four, sorry, 75 horsepower. I think, thereabouts. These body panels are made of cotton. It's a bloody starting. Not a smetch enough to avoid mushrooms, pair of pushing and stun up. So sorry, everyone, it's been to Russia.
What does it take to be a pedigree company? The right equipment. I'd rather see some hustle out there, guys. That's right, stay low. Sure, I want to see him post up. It's gonna be a long season.
Really, this can all be summed up by saying the Lada